Olá, eu sou o David Heck, CEO e fundador da Reamp. Provavelmente, nos últimos dias, você deve ter acompanhado no mercado que agora a Reamp faz parte da Jellyfish. Por que fizemos esse movimento? Por que a Jellyfish? A nossa preocupação era trazer ao mercado brasileiro uma empresa global com grande expertise em transformação e que tivesse os valores alinhados com o nosso. Viemos em uma trajetória atendendo o mercado nos últimos 10 anos através das agências, passamos a atender em conjunto com elas e agora entendemos que temos que trabalhar em conjunto com os grandes anunciantes, pois o mercado de edtech vem mudando e existe um momento muito importante no Brasil, principalmente com essa chegada da Jellyfish, onde é necessário que o anunciante assuma a propriedade dos dados, assuma a direção de marketing e atue à frente desse negócio. Porque em todo o mundo, empresas terceirizam atividades fabris, serviços, tecnologia, mas o grande asset tem se tornado os dados, a inteligência de mercado, todas as informações que podem ser colhidas e gerar aprendizado para o seu negócio, inclusive capacitando equipes e sistemas de informação ao desenvolvimento futuro e predição com inteligência artificial, que só será possível para aqueles que colheram essas informações e geraram aprendizados em cima de todas as suas campanhas. A essência da publicidade, ela não mudou. Ela continua sendo a de provocar o encontro de consumidor e marca. O que mudou é a forma de se fazer isso. Mudou a velocidade, mudou a forma como se operacionaliza, mudaram os capabilities necessários para que o time consiga atender esta demanda. Enquanto 71% dos CMOs reconhecem a importância de dados para nutrir informações para o negócio da sua companhia, auxiliando inteligência de mercado, especificação de produtos, automação, processos de predição, 81% dos profissionais de marketing alegam que não possuem até hoje uma visão unificada dessas informações. E temos a LGPD aí, que só é possível cumprir todos os protocolos se existe uma visão unificada sobre o consumidor. Tudo isso somente é possível através da internalização, seja qual for o modelo, o que chamamos de in-house. E esta é uma grande proposta da Jellyfish, que traz ao Brasil um formato inovador de digital partner, onde os dados pertencem ao anunciante, o anunciante coparticipa de toda a operação, é um modelo totalmente transparente, baseado apenas em tecnologia e serviços, onde a empresa tem a liberdade de construir o seu ativo de forma contínua. Mas tanto falamos sobre in-house aqui no Brasil de uma forma tão lúdica, que será que realmente hoje os anunciantes já entendem qual é a governança ideal, como construir isso, quais são as dicas de ouro dentro do seu negócio, como escolher um parceiro? São muitas perguntas, né? Para isso, trouxemos o Gavin Owen, que é um diretor de estratégia global da Jellyfish, com base no Reino Unido. O Gavin é uma pessoa que já fez trabalhos dentro de grandes anunciantes. Ele atuou com Nestlé e Diageo. Ele conhece o outro lado da mesa. E ele tem uma postura muito interessante, que eu gosto demais, porque o Gavin, ele não mede as palavras. Ele vai trazer aquilo que você realmente gostaria de saber e falta hoje no mercado. Como que realmente essa operação deve funcionar? O que está por trás da cortina? E é isso que eu gostaria de trazer um pouco para vocês hoje. Então, agora eu deixo com o Gavin.
Thank you, David, for the very warm introduction. As David said, my name is Gavin, and you'll see on screen are my contact details. It's really important today that you don't take your phones out and start taking pictures of the slides. All of our slides are completely open source and are available for you. We're more than happy to change the language. We're more than happy to add your company logos, or even just send us your slide deck templates and we'll insert these slides. It's really important that today we can discuss this in a really open and honest and transparent manner. The classic marketing funnel has not changed. Hearts, minds, and actions. Hearts, awareness-driving campaigns, targeting reach and frequency, embedding the wonder of your particular brand with a message that with engaging formats. The minds, prospecting the target audience to increase frequency and encourage downstream engagement. actions. Ensure maximum findability of your particular product. Capture users and drive them to find out more, ultimately enabling your customers, your consumers, to purchase your product. Repeat purchase and ultimately become advocates of your brand. Traditionally, as marketeers, we've engaged with our consumers in an analog fashion: television, print, and radio. The consumer today, your target audience, irrespective of the country they live in, are spending more and more time online. The internet is becoming ingrained within our DNA. 4.1 million search queries every 60 seconds, 190 million emails sent every minute. From a paid media perspective, the internet minute brings your organization a massive opportunity to engage with people in a way that they've not been able to do before, using smart targeting. This personalized engagement strategy is what delivers results through the marketing funnel. However, if we're honest, whilst what I've spoken about so far is the ideal, the reality is very different. Year on year, the organizations that you work for, I've worked for, are investing more and more money in digital media. What comes with this is scrutiny. I doubt a day goes by where one of your colleagues does not approach you and ask you a question. After all, you are the fountain of knowledge when it comes to all things digital. Those questions always relate to your target audience, your consumer, because the way consumers are engaging media is changing, the platforms are changing. If we think back 3 years back, if someone came and asked you your thoughts on TikTok, you would probably ask them what TikTok is. Now, it's one of the most engaging platforms out there. You, as the fountain of knowledge, need that viewpoint. In 2020, it's socially acceptable to talk about Tinder and how you slide left or right. What comes with that is marketing opportunities. As an alcohol brand, why would you not want to engage with people on their first date? Sliding a message into their messages and telling them about the bar they might be going to and the alcohol they can actually consume whilst there. If this was not challenging enough, the shift of consumer from radio to music streaming services such as Spotify, the continuation of print media to online, and in 2020, television to OTT offerings. I use OTT as a catch-all term, but how many subscription VOD services is too many for you? Amazon, Netflix, Disney Plus, sports subscriptions. That's just four that I personally have myself, but how many is too many? Again, many of these bring advertising opportunities which you need to consider for your company. E-commerce. In the 60 seconds, 1.1 million is spent online every 60 seconds. And I'm sure over the past 6 months, this has only increased. If you're either selling directly online or working with e-commerce players, I'm sure you're regularly being asked if you're doing it in the most efficient manner. Whilst the above is familiar to us, we're also skilled enough to answer these in a compelling manner to ensure our peer questions are satisfied and we can concentrate on the tasks in hand. However, what we can't regulate is the noise from outside our four walls. This type of noise in my career essentially wrecked my calendar for the next 2 days. I was writing papers after papers after papers, justifying why the company I worked for was actually doing better, why we were actually exceeding targets, and why those comments being made in the trade press were not actually relevant to us. The first example, e-commerce, the chief digital officer of L'Oreal saying what they achieved in 8 weeks would normally take 3 years. The email lands in your inbox and immediately you need to clear your diary to give that viewpoint of what your organization is doing. The email has come directly from your CEO. Mark Pritchard, I knew when I woke up in the morning when I was at Nestle, I knew that Mark Pritchard had been speaking because I already had 14 emails in my inbox from my manager, from my manager's manager, and from my manager's manager's managers, asking exactly what Mark Pritchard meant and why we as Nestle were already exceeding, why we were actually doing better than what Mark Pritchard was talking about. And then the other hot topic, in-housing. And I finally used the word in-housing in this presentation. Maybe one of your competitors or a global brand puts out a press release. It's spoken about in the trade press. In this example, Vodafone are in-housing their paid media. And again, your manager's manager, and your manager's 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 managers, right up at the top of the company organization, want to know what are we doing around this thorny topic of in-housing. And again, you need to clear your diary. You're writing papers for 2 days, putting your company in the perfect limelight, speaking about the work you do on a daily basis and why you believe the organization is achieving significant growth in a controlled fashion. I'm going to use the word again. However, if I was with you now, I would ask you a series of questions. I'd walk out the room and go and make myself a coffee and come back in 10 minutes. And those questions would be, can you tell me yesterday exactly how much you spent in paid media? Can you tell me yesterday every single website you appeared on? Can you tell me yesterday for each of those websites, what were the formats? Was it video? Was it display? Can you tell me exactly how much you paid for each of those impressions? Can you log in to the marketing technology platforms that may well have been used by your agency partners? And the list goes on. However, if we're going to be honest with each other today, the chances are after 10 minutes, you would ask me for another 10 minutes. And after 10 minutes, you would ask me for another half a day. You'd be on the phone to your agency partners asking these questions. Because the reality is, we would know probably none of these answers. Or if we knew something, it would be incredibly limited. However, and I think what we're seeing already is to answer some of these questions, it's not just you. You need your colleagues from procurement. You need your colleagues from the finance team, from the legal team, to almost become part of a digital committee as we potentially go through this change. If I was to ask you some simple questions, television, can you tell me how competitive your TV rates are? You and your procurement colleagues would tell me how your TV rates have been third-party vetted and you have market-leading TV rates. If I asked your legal team around who owns the data, they would tell me that your master service agreement with your agency partners specify you own all of the data. However, ask those marketing technology vendors. The odds are, as we potentially go through this change, you're going to lose a lot of data. If I was to ask you, what are your payment terms with your agencies? People would very proudly tell me it's 120 days. However, what are the payment terms your agencies have with marketing technology and publishers? Probably considerably less. So on one hand, the principles of your media supply chain, the principles of knowing where your advertising is going, is not known. We can't log into the platforms. We don't know where we appeared yesterday. However, the historical benchmarks in our organization around TV pricing, perceived data ownership, and payment terms are well known by all. I want to introduce a new concept at this point. It's a concept that I worked on when I was at Nestle and when I was at Diageo. And it's actually something I wasn't actually aware at the time, but Mark Pritchard also speaks about. Mark Pritchard's saying there's one more step in creating the new media supply chain, and that's marketeers, you, operating as brand entrepreneurs by taking control of your own destiny, controlling your own destiny to deliver consumer engagement. Taking control of our destiny is what in-housing is for me. Having a reset, understanding the current to enable us to deliver consumer engagement, to deliver compelling elements of the marketing funnel in a controlled manner where we know every single step of the journey. Being that brand entrepreneur that Mark Pritchard talks about. Typically at this point, it's just not you, as I said. You'll be engaging with your colleagues from procurement. You'll be engaging with your colleagues from finance. You'll be thinking, help. We know we need to change our operating model. And at this point, I'd be surprised if you haven't been engaging with consultancies such as Accenture or Deloitte, who may already be plugged in at the C-level of your organization. Potentially dealing with marketing technology specialists, independents, who also have a viewpoint on what you should be doing. Potentially, you might have started to engage with your agency partners and telling them. And all of a sudden, they tell you about this in-housing team who can absolutely help you, but they've never told you about that team before. Or you might be engaging directly with marketing technology vendors. But what I guarantee, and I guarantee with a capital G, is that 99.9% of those people you speak to have never actually done your job. They've never actually worked within a brand. They don't understand the unique challenges. They don't understand how your organization is structured. They don't understand exactly what you're trying to achieve, but immediately they've got a viewpoint on how they can help fix you. And that is what I want to discuss now. After several meetings, you decide that you need to put an RFP into market. And this is what I really want to concentrate on, because for me and the other vendors you engage with, we really need your help at this point. Typically, an RFP will be two pages if we're lucky. The RFP will start with a little bit of your company information. You'll then tell us what your key markets are and what your key brands are. It will lack information around your current operating model. It will lack details around how much you're spending on paid media. You'll then tell me that your marketing technology rates cannot go up. You may well still require the 120-day payment terms, And could I please tell you exactly how much this project will cost from end to end? And please, could you send me the information by noon tomorrow? The reality is, if you want to be that brand entrepreneur, if you want to control your own destiny, that RFP needs more details. However, this is not in your wheelhouse at this point. You are the fountain of knowledge for all things digital. You understand the platforms, you understand consumer engagement. We are starting to delve into this supply chain management world. We're starting to understand what's going on. We're starting to ask questions. However, this is something that we're learning as we're going. And therefore, I want to introduce the five golden rules. The five golden rules to enable you to write a compelling RFP document that will enable the vendors you want to engage with to come back to you and try and build something that is bespoke and relevant to you. Golden rule number one, fully understand the current. Thinking about the principles of supply chain management. If you haven't met with your supply chain team, I really urge you to put a session in with them and ask how they procure your raw materials. Thinking about coffee, from bean to cup. That coffee bean, your supply chain would understand on what day that bean was sown, how it ended up in your cup. They would understand every single piece of the journey. They might not own all of those relationships. They might work with third-party vendors. However, they understand from bean to cup. Bringing this back into your life, understand what your partners are doing for you. How do they plan media? Where do they place the adverts? How do the publishers amplify your content? What are the buying standards you might have in place? How do they optimize your campaigns? And how do they report on campaign success? It's really important to take that from bean to cup mentality to understand end to end what is going on within your consumer engagement. Be honest with yourselves. How efficient, how effective is your current ways? You might not be able to find out everything. Understand the totality of the resource required and the timelines and the challenges. You'll start to assign roles for change. Your colleagues working around you will start to take on parts of this project. To be able to demonstrate the clear and actionable change, you'll need this information. You'll need this for your brief to allow the people you want to engage with to fully understand the current. Golden rule number two, marketing technology. You need to own the vast majority of this software. There are no two ways about it. It is the only way you can legally own your data. And in a world where consumer engagement is driven by data, you need to own this data. It is the only way you can control who has access to your platforms. What email addresses are they using? What happens when someone leaves the organization? It is the only way you can fully understand exactly where your marketing dollars are going. You can log into your platforms and fully understand what publishers you appeared on yesterday, how many impressions, how much you paid for them. And for the first time, you'll be able to answer lots of those questions as I walked out the room and went and got that coffee. You are starting to take control of your marketing and media supply chain. Golden rule number two is evaluate the marketing software. You may well not be in a position to know who you want to work with. Put that into your RFP. Get viewpoints, but ultimately you need to own marketing technology and the vendors need to be your choice. Golden rule number three, define your operating model. The term in-house is a catch-all term, as we've already said, it's a catch-all term for change. When we start to consider what are those operating models, at the very least is you owning the marketing technology to enable you to answer those basic questions. There is a sliding scale towards in-house, but the most common approach is a hybrid solution. And what we mean by hybrid is shared roles and responsibilities. Very, very clear. The very, very least, and this is where you are employed today, is the voice of reason. So we're moving from that, I own my technology and my agency still operates in the way they always have, to you starting to put some more rigor. You starting to control that media supply chain. As we move towards the more right-hand side of hybrid, you may well hire colleagues to also help you to understand what is going on. You might actually in-house your data management. You may well have analytics experts in-house to build audiences. You may well be considering media planning in-house. But this is what you need to brief in. Within your RFP, You need to establish the operating model. You might have a viewpoint at this point, but work with the partners during the RFP to understand. And then on the right-hand side, very, 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 with a capital V, brands are in-housing fully at this point. And this would be the end-to-end from bean to cup. Historically, your business has not been a media agency. We need an operating model that gives you what you need. However, understand the principles, understand there are experts out there who can very much help enable you to deliver what you need to deliver. As part of this process, as you work out your operational readiness, as you start to work out what is my operating model, your colleagues will be asking you, what are the benefits of in-housing and what are some of the drawbacks? I've grouped these into finance, strategic, and operational. First of all, let's look at the positives that will help you define your operating model. We absolutely can say there's greater fee transparency, operational transparency, and incentive to perform. You'll be able to look at the change history and understand how your partners are optimizing campaigns. From a strategic perspective, you control the technology. Someone else is not telling you what you should be using. It's your technology and your data. Potentially full-time staff. Roadmap ownership. You're controlling your own destiny. Becoming that brand entrepreneur. You're controlling your operating model and how that might change over time. Media accountability. Appearing on the websites you want to appear on. And from an operational perspective, direct contract with vendors. Ask any questions you want. Push, prod, and pull them in the direction you want to do that. All decisions are owned by you, the brand. However, there are reasons not to in-house. Potentially higher technology costs. You're not going to have that volume benefit that your current partner might have. The fixed costs can be challenging for a seasonal business. If you only advertise 2 to 3 times a year, fully in-housing the desk to keyboard operation might not be wise for you. From a strategic perspective, it can be harder to innovate, to keep up with the marketplace because you're insular. And it might also not be possible to buy all inventory. So again, understand what publishers are key to you and understand how you can purchase that inventory. From an operational perspective, your business might have a lack of infrastructure. It might only be you, and the opportunity to scale that team could be challenging. It's hard to recruit and train the very best staff, particularly outside of tier one markets. And if a key hire leaves, you have no backup. In summary, be clear in your RFP document. What is your operating model today? And how do you see that changing over the next 18 months? Be really, really clear if you think it's going to be a hybrid solution, if it's going to be fully in-house, and very much lay out where you see the opportunity and where you see those challenges might be, and understand how a partner will be able to help you overcome and achieve this. Golden rule number 4, strategic direction inside your own business. Whilst you and your committee are absolutely committed to change. Maybe not everyone is. How are you taking the organization on this journey? How are you ensuring that everyone understands why the current today is no longer sustainable? Why you need to be the brand entrepreneurs and very much change your in-housing or your current marketing approach to deliver that consumer engagement? How are you going to keep people informed around the potential technology choices and the importance of owning the technology, even if that costs slightly more? From a strategic perspective, do people fully understand the reasons why the change needs to happen? From a cultural perspective, is the organization used to change, or is it an organization that rarely makes change? How can we start to explain to people that the change needs to happen? From a process perspective, do you have the totality of the company aiming in the right direction? And from a people perspective, and people are the most important point in any company, how are we going to ensure that everyone, right down from the very grassroots to the organization, which I typically refer to as mission, how are we going to ensure they understand exactly what consumer engagement is in 2020 and beyond? What is the importance of social media? What is the importance of programmatic? What is the importance of paid search? How can we deliver engaging and compelling training to those individuals? From a values perspective, you as the digital experts, how can we ensure that you are the specialist? How can we provide deep, ingrained training to enable you to really understand the nuances of programmatic, the nuances of social, the nuances of exactly what is going on in consumer engagement? And then from the visionary perspective, how can you work
with your board, ensuring from that organizational change perspective, it's led from the very top, delivering that change, the endorsement from your global CEO into why change is needed.
As we deliver this organizational change, you're also being asked, how are we going to demonstrate excellence? How are we going to demonstrate this change? And that is also very, very personal to you. On the screen is an example of my time at Nestle and how we actually demonstrated how we were changing our media supply path, how we were getting under the hood, understanding what was going on, but still working very much in a hybrid solution. So in summary, ensuring your RFP, you're asking exactly how these companies, how these organizations you're looking to partner with have delivered change. Have they delivered it in partnership with people like yourself? You understand your business, you understand the nuances, but allow them to bring thoughts into your mind to enable you to make that change. And then most importantly, how are you going to celebrate this change? How are you going to demonstrate the excellence you're putting in place by the elements of in-housing and changing your operating model? So my final golden rule, irrespective of what your operating model is going to be, whether you're just going to own the technology, whether you're going to start to lean in, or most importantly, if you are going to own the end-to-end execution, is taking that mentality, taking the bean to cup viewpoint. When was the last time any of you met with a publisher? Hopefully by now, by understanding the current, you're aware of which of the key publishers your organization spends with. Meet with them, engage with them. Tell them about your business. Ensure the publisher is aware of your target audiences and campaign objectives. I highly doubt they are at the moment. Do they understand exactly what your principles are around brand safety, ad fraud, and viewability? How do they measure it? How does a publisher yield optimize its inventory? Can the publisher deliver to your price point? And what audience data does the publisher have, and how can you use it? Thinking about the principles of media supply chain management that Mark Pritchard spoke about, is you are the entrepreneur, you are very much the change agent. You need to understand the answers to those questions. You need to understand how the publishers are delivering inventory. This needs to come across clearly in the RFP. You're going to need help from these vendors to enable you to take it from bean to cup, to really understand how you can deliver that consumer engagement with your key publishers. This is something that is often overlooked. I very, very rarely see an RFP that comes through to me where a brand that is looking to deliver this form of digital transformation is really being clear and upfront in the publishers it wishes to engage with. That may very well change the desired operating model. It might change the marketing technology requirements. It might change the organizational change that is required internally. However, the bean to cup mentality is exactly what Mark Pritchard was speaking about. So those five golden rules are very much there to help you, to enable you to write a compelling RFP document. So in summary, when David handed over to me, you probably thought for the next 20, 25 minutes, Gavin was going to talk about in-housing. I think if we actually look back through this presentation, I'd have used the term in-housing less than five times. That is because it's about delivering the operational change. The operational change is required due to the way the consumer is engaging with media today, the changes that we spoke about. Those changes mean that you need to pivot. You need to change your current ways. You need to take the principles of media supply chain marketing and very much work with the partners out there to enable you to answer those questions, to understand what your desired operating model is, to enable you to own the marketing technology, which means you own your own data. You're controlling your own destiny. Working with smart partners out there who can really enable you and your organization from top down to grasp those changes. For the very, very first time for many of you, to engage with those publishers, to meet those publishers, to talk to those publishers. Let those publishers thank you for your spend. And most importantly, understand how the consumers engage with those platforms. So in summary, in-housing is not a scary topic. In-housing is about enabling you as the marketeer. When your colleagues reach out to you, or you see that news that's coming out from third party that lands in your inbox in the morning from your managers, it enables you to say, pause, stop. We're in control of our own destiny. We understand that digital marketing is only going to increase. However, as an organization, we understand what we're doing. Thank you.